Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Philippe Matthews Show. Not live. This is Philippe Matthews Show pre-recorded. But I am here with a great, I consider him a friend, but he's also an expert. He's a regular contributor to Time Magazine. He's a decision-making scientist and emotional and social intelligence expert and the author of The Truth Seeker's Handbook, A Science-Based Guide. And he's the assistant professor at the Decision Sciences Collaborative and History Department at Ohio State University, and it could be none other than Dr. Gleb Tsipursky. How are you, my friend?
Good to see you, my friend, as well. It's been nice to have these conversations with you, and it's good to talk to you once again.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, as I was telling you before we started recording, that I just have been absorbing and living your research, literally. Changed my life. Mm-hmm. And as a African-American man, I saw that there were certain cognitive biases that I had, but also I saw that there were cognitive biases that were in the culture and the personality of, if you will, non-melanated people or people of color. And so I said, I would really love to have a hardcore conversation with Dr. Gleb Tsipursky on these issues and see how we can look at the basically racialized cognitive biases. So before we do that and have that conversation, let's start by, for my first interview, I don't know what, 2 years or so ago, let's talk about what critical thinking errors are and cognitive biases are to give the people who are hearing this for the first time some context.
Sure. So our minds, according to research, are adapted for the savannah, not the modern environment. That means that our intuitions, our gut reactions, our emotions, that's what they're about. They're savanna reactions. And in many cases, in the modern environment, they don't serve us well. So for example, when your boss gives you constructive critical feedback, your intuition is to have either a defensive response or an aggressive response. To kind of shout back, no, you know, I'm awesome, you know, why are you criticizing me? Or to shut down and ignore your boss's criticism. That's a two kind of intuitive responses. Neither of them will help your career. You know, you're better off just learning and incorporating the boss's feedback into your performance. That's one example. Another example is eating sweets. Now, I have an Achilles heel for cheesecake. You know, I love cheesecake. You know, that's a problem for me. And that's a problem for all of us to have as much sugar and sweets as possible because it was beneficial for our survival in the savannah. Not so good now. That's another example. And the whole framework for what's going on here is that we all have a series of thinking errors called cognitive biases. That's what the scholars call them. More than 100 of them altogether. You can look them up on Wikipedia or in my book, The Truth Seeker's Handbook, A Science-Based Guide. So these are thinking errors that we typically have. And they all come back from two types of thinking that we have, two thinking systems. One is called the autopilot system. That's our intuitive habitual system, also called system one. It's the gut reactions. It's the habits. That's the savanna environment. It's our emotions and intuitions. Feels very comfortable, very convenient, but often wrong. The second system of thinking we have is much slower, much harder to implement. That's our intentional system. That's the one that deals with abstract reasoning. That's the one where you try to restrain yourself from eating that second piece of cheesecake, and you try to get yourself out of your chair and go out and do some exercises, or you try to restrain yourself from shouting back at your boss. That's the intentional system, much harder to use, much more effortful. So that's kind of the basic framework of why we have these thinking errors that we do and why we make these mistakes, including in racialized settings.
Excellent. Thank you for that. I'm still feeling the cheesecake. I have to have it. And I'm the boss, so I yell at myself. So probably I'm failing at that too. So we'll get some more work done on that. So you write in the book about mental patterns are determined by our genes. The other half is determined by our environment and experience. So when you're talking about the savannah, you're talking about our ancient African history or what have you in terms of how the environment shaped our value systems axiologically, psychologically, and so on and so forth. So just as we are born today, the how we were raised, where we were raised, the environment, the socialization, that affects our behavior and mental patterns?
Absolutely. So in this, one of the biggest things impacting racial issues is tribalism. In the savannah, you needed to be with your tribe to survive. Basically, if you weren't bonded with your tribe, if you weren't helping them out, if you weren't looking out for them, you wouldn't survive. We are all the children. We are all the descendants of people who had a very strong tribal instinct. The people who didn't have a strong tribal instinct just didn't survive. That's the Darwinian mechanism of evolution, right? Mm-hmm. So they didn't survive. So we all have tribal instincts. Now, if you look at children, little babies, they have more positive reactions to other babies who look like them rather than babies who don't. And that's kind of a very basic thing. You can see how it's evolved in the genes. There is no experience that they have that would cause them to have these negative reactions. So that's, so if you look at their, whether they smile on their faces or not when they're exposed to babies of other skin color. And that's one example of whether it's genetic. Of course, the other aspect of it is mimetic. Memes refers to not internet memes, but...
Right, I know, memetics, study by Richard Dawkins, 1976.
Exactly. Yeah. You know it. I'm talking to your audience who may not know it. So it's a study of how ideas influence us. And so it's our experience, which you mentioned before, the kind of environment we have, the kind of growth patterns that we experienced because of our parents and so on. And that's the part we can control. So maybe about 50% of it is DNA that we can't control. 50% of it is something we can control. So we can control our tribalism, but it's not intuitive at all. It's very intuitive for us to be tribal. It's very intuitive for us to have negative reactions, to have implicit bias toward people with different skin color than we are. And this applies to both black people, white people, Asian people, and so on. Asians would like other Asians more than white people or black people. Black people would like other black people more than black people and white people. White people would like other white people. Same thing refers to males and females and so on. Whatever you consider part of your tribal background, you would tend to like those people more. It's very natural, it's very intuitive. So many people, when they talk about this, they use a framework of, you should be ashamed of feeling of those feelings, you should be feel guilty. And that's not really helpful at all, because these are natural feelings. I mean, should you feel guilty about wanting a second piece of cheesecake? No, it's just kind of a natural intuitive desire. You can't control, in that sense, your intuitions. What you can control is your behaviors. And so in the same way that it's natural to want a second piece of cheesecake, but it's civilized to choose to not have it. It's natural to like other people who have your color of skin, but it's civilized to treat everyone equally based on their merit and how they deserve.
Okay, so that's really good. You talk about, it's better to hold myself 100% responsible for my actions, but 0% responsible for my feelings.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but so that's...
I love that.
That's the essence of that point, that in the moment, you can't change your feelings. You can change your feelings over the long term with a lot of efforts, and my book talks about how to do that. But in the moment, you can't change what you feel. You can only control your behaviors. That's something you can control. So you can't change how you feel about other people. You can change how you behave toward them, making sure that you treat them equally. And you give, you treat everyone based on their merit, based on their character, not based on their tribal identity.
Okay. All right. So let's get into some of the biases that were so intriguing. I had a gentleman by the name of Professor James Duane on my show. He was a district attorney and wrote an amazing book on the Fifth Amendment. And he was talking about the confirmation bias that law enforcement has. Mm-hmm. And I said, do you know Gleb Tsipursky? And so I know this stuff has been around for a long time, but you know, you're the kind of unequivocal guy. So I said, wow, that was really intuitive that he knows about confirmation bias within the policing system. Talk to us about and explain confirmation bias, but explain it from a racialized perspective. Sure. And how that works.
So the confirmation bias is our tendency to look for information that conforms to our beliefs and also interpret information that conforms to our beliefs. For example, we know from a lot of polling data that Black people are stopped on highways for various issues at a much higher rate than white people. That means that police officers tend to look for black drivers intuitively without intending to. That's just their confirmation. They have an intuitive belief that black people will tend to break laws more often than white people. And therefore, they look for cars with black drivers and stop those cars more often. So that's kind of one situation, looking for the situation. The other aspect is interpreting the situation in ways that conforms to our beliefs. So once you stop a car, how do you treat the passenger in the car? We know that black people have violence used against them in police settings at about twice to three times the rate of white people for the same sort of infraction. Mm-hmm. So that's already, you are not looking for the information, you're interpreting the information. Mm-hmm. So if you see a black person, if a white police officer sees a black person take out something that's vaguely object-shaped, the white police officer is going to be much more likely to believe that the black person is pulling out a gun rather than his wallet to show his ID card. So that's an example of where the white police officer would have a negative interpretation of the black person's actions. So again, looking for information and interpreting information in ways that conforms to your beliefs of traffic.
Thank you for that. And also, we've seen too, it doesn't really matter if the cop is white because of the socialization inherent in law enforcement, mm-hmm. Asian, Hispanic, and Indian, other nationalities or ethnicities of law enforcement seem to have that same level of bias against African Americans.
Yes, so it's not about who you inherently are, but about your inherent beliefs. So if you believe black people tend to commit crimes at a higher rate, you would tend to stop cars with black passengers and then interpret their actions in a more negative way than you would white people, regardless of your own background.
Okay, excellent. Now, how does confirmation bias differ from anchoring bias?
So anchoring bias is where you are currently anchored. Anchoring bias refers to what your current belief system is, and that your anchor develops from your first exposure to a topic. So for example, if a police officer enters the police academy, someone who will become a police officer, and her first exposure to the topic of black people versus white people is a senior police officer saying, you need to look out for black people, they commit crimes more often. That's the kind of exposure they have.
And so now, that's an anchor.
Right, exactly. If her first exposure is in a class on diversity training where they say, hey, we tend to have more negative stereotypes of black people, you need to deliberately go against your intuitions and deliberately choose to avoid seeing black people as more likely to commit crimes, she'll be anchored at a different point. She'll be anchored to treat black people in a more thoughtful and considerate way. So that's the anchoring effect. And where we are anchored, it tends to be very hard for us to pull away from that initial anchor, which is why it's so important to have accurate messages presented in the first place to the population.
So that anchor is the first part, and then that over time creates that confirmation bias.
Yes. Exactly.
So where does the mirror exposure effect come in with anchoring and confirmation and so on?
The mere exposure effect refers to the idea that the more we're exposed to a topic, the more comfortable we are with a topic. So let's say if we're exposed to black people not committing crimes, then we become more and more used to, oh, this black person is a very nice person, not committing a crime. So that's what happens in real life. The vast majority of interactions we have with people, they're not going to be committing crimes. However, if you're isolated and don't spend time interacting with black people, and all you see is things in the media or rumors from social media about black people committing crimes, you're not actually exposed to those black people in how they are in real life. Mm-hmm. And therefore, you're much less likely to be comfortable with them in that exposure. And so that will deeply influence how you perceive things.
Fantastic. Excellent. All right. So we can also look at that in terms of this overall way that what we call white fragility or white supremacy or white privilege, mm-hmm. we can look at that from a halo and horns.
That's right. So that's kind of a fundamental aspect of tribalism. The halo effect is one of our cognitive biases, one of the two relevant ones, where we tend to like people who share our characteristics. When they have a characteristic that we perceive as part of our tribal group, we tend to like them. Now, this can refer to skin color. This can refer to things like accents. This can refer to things like, you know, sports. So as a professor at Ohio State University, you know, contractually obligated to root for the Buckeyes, right? So that's kind of the halo effect there in sports. And it refers to many other things where we perceive people who are part of our tribe. That's the white people tend to promote white people. Black people tend to promote black people. Asians tend to promote Asians at workplaces. This has been shown by surveys and research on this topic. The other aspect of it is horns effect. That's the opposite. When we don't like a characteristic of someone, then we tend to not like that person as a whole. So if we, for, you know, if I'm rooting for the Buckeyes, then the Michigan fans are going to be the big enemy. Right. And that's kind of how it applies to football. It can apply to skin color. It can apply to anything. If, for example, some people have negative beliefs about Muslims committing terrorist acts, whereas the vast majority of Muslims are peaceful people. But because of the portrayals in the media, if they lack that exposure to Muslims in real life, they will have negative feelings about Muslims. So that's another example of where horns effect comes into play in racialized ethnic cultural settings.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. So when we look at the 45th calling football players, mothers, SOBs and what have you, those are the kind of things that create a swath. Because, you know, most people don't know they have two parts of their brain that you know, an intentional and the autopilot system. And so that tribalness just speaks to that tribal nature of that base of people. But it also infects the ones who are trying to think logically, because you talk about this, the false consensus effect. So over time, you keep saying something over and over and over again, it starts to infect and affect that autopilot system or that intentional system.
Yes, so the false consensus effect is the idea that we share a lot of beliefs with other people. Now, we tend to assume that other people are more like us than they actually are. So, for example, if, let's say you talked about, you know, 45th and his base. If he says something, right now, for example, he's criticizing Harley-Davidson for moving some of their jobs to Europe and elsewhere because of the tariffs that his trade war is placing on the U.S. Okay. So now he's criticizing Harley-Davidson. And the assumption among many of his base is that Harley-Davidson is bad because Trump says it's bad. Now, many other people in his base might like Harley-Davidson, but because they don't communicate about it to each other, they don't go out and say, well, despite what 45th says, I still like Harley-Davidson. They will have the assumption that other people in his base, that everybody else besides them, doesn't like Harley Davidson. So because of Trump's saying.
So that's the point. So is that also part of the illusory truth effect?
The illusory truth effect is more close to the mere exposure effect. The more you're exposed to a false statement, the more all you believe that false statement. And so, for example, Trump often calls CNN fake news or something like that, or MSNBC fake news. And his base will tend to think that these news channels are just full of falsehoods, whereas in reality, they're not. Not any more than, let's say, Fox News or something like that. Mm-hmm. If you look at the actual credible fact checkers that fact check each of these organizations and see how many times they report actual falsehoods. But the illusory truth effect is a subcomponent of that. So the more often you hear a lie, the more likely you are to believe it.
What's that quote? You hear a lie long enough or enough times, the truth becomes unbelievable, something to that effect. Hitler's number two guy. So this is great because it's understanding how this works as a cognitive bias, but also from a neuroscience, it's like this is something that's happening in the brain. And it gives us an ability to look at a human being as a human being. And saying they are not necessarily at the moment in control of their rational mind or intentional mind, they are triggered by the tribal mind, if you will, from their years of socialization and being a part of that environment that has created that initial trigger. So this is good stuff.
This is very important to see that, because if you don't see that, you'll just presume that other people are bad people just because they have these beliefs. Right. They should be ashamed. They should be guilty. Whereas these are natural intuitions. And right. So the key for us is to, do we play into the natural intuitions as, you know, number 45 and some others would have us do, or do we become more civilized? And so that's
the fact, as you said, you know, are all white people, if I'm a black person or African-American person, all white people are bad. If I'm a white person, all black people, all Mexicans, all others are bad. Mm-hmm. And that is the tribal thinking.
That is the tribal kind of natural and intuitive thinking. That's what we have to realize. Just like eating all the sugar is natural and intuitive. We have to deliberately fight against that in order to be civilized and live in our modern world.
Excellent. And that's a very big point, that you have to fight against it. Otherwise, you just go to the default. Mm-hmm. Attentional bias.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So attentional bias plays into racism in a powerful way, because it's about what is emotionally salient to us. So the whatever is emotionally salient to us, emotionally important to that autopilot system, becomes overwhelmingly important to the rest of us. So for example, if the news media show a story about a black person killing a white person, that news story is going to be powerfully impactful for people. They have visual imagery, they have stories, and people are going to be remembering that rather than the nice, normal black families all around them who would never do a thing like that. So, and these are not families that are shown on television, because the news media definitely tends to show us whatever is negative, whatever will get people's attention, whatever will arouse emotion. So attentional bias, that's a way that it plays into racism. It plays into many other things. So for example, the news media tend to show us airplane crashes very prominently, very frequently. Mm-hmm. However, traveling on airplanes is about 100 times safer than traveling on cars. It's just that car crashes are not nearly as grotesque and large and huge as airplane crashes. So they're not shown on the television, and therefore we don't really think about them as a problem.
And so, again, that attentional bias feeds into that halo and horns as well.
Yes, it does. Absolutely. So whether we like a person, whether we don't like a person.
Here is one that really fascinated me. I mean, I just so freaking love this book, and I'm so happy that you did it. Because when we first talked, you didn't have that book yet. I think you might have been writing it. But you had some other great stuff, and we'll talk about that in upcoming shows. But boy, when you came out with this one, jeez, game changer. What was most fascinating to me about this is the backfire effect. Mm-hmm. I just look at the state that we're in America right now, and there are just people, particularly in the current administration, that no matter how much fact you bring to them, and truth and evidence you bring to them, it backfires. I did not know there was such a thing. I just said, well, maybe you just need to try harder. Maybe you need to do this. Maybe you didn't. No, there's an actual mechanism in the brain that backfires. Talk to us about the backfire effect and how that is racialized.
Sure. So the backfire effect is a phenomenon where when we try to correct somebody's misconceptions, the misconceptions may not be corrected and may sometimes even become worse in some situations. It's surprising. We would think, like you said, that, well, when we bring more evidence to the table, they would be more likely to update their beliefs, change their beliefs, and believe in the more accurate thing. That's not how it works. Why? Because of tribalism and community around that. So people perceive themselves to be in tribes, in ideological tribes, tribes of belief. So we talked about the base of Trump, or the same thing that applied to liberal people, and so on. So there's a certain base, and if you admit a certain fact that goes against your tribe's belief, that means that you are going to be excluded from the tribe, People don't want that. Mm-hmm. People don't like that. They don't want to be excluded from that tribal belief. So let's say we talk about Muslims. Let's go back to that. Now, if you go to somebody who is conservative and just doesn't like Muslims, doesn't want Muslim immigrants, and you tell them, hey, look at this evidence. Muslims are not terrorists. This is a ridiculous statement to equate Muslims with terrorists. If you look at the actual statistics, that there are something like, I don't remember, something like 9 Muslims involved in terrorist acts in the US in 2016 out of 1.8 million adult Muslims. Mm-hmm. That's like 1 out of 200,000.
Right.
Some ridiculous number, right? So they will have a really hard time admitting that. And they will often just say, well, whatever, I don't care about what you're saying. You know, then Muslims are still terrorists to me, because otherwise they will have to leave their in-group. And the same thing can be about Mexicans, and the same thing can be about white people and black people, you know, admitting that black people actually are quite nice and friendly and just like regular folks next door. They just want the same things that you do. That was going to be really hard for me.
Remember when Obama was running? You remember when Obama was running and was against McCain, and there was this lady in the audience when McCain was doing a town hall, and she said, yes, she got up and said, Obama's a Muslim, and then McCain actually corrected her. That was a beautiful example of a backfire effect, right? That was great. That was great. So, and then when it happened with Trump, he just went in and went further in. This is why I think your work today is so radically important. It's probably the most important time in our history for this work. So I'm one of those kind of cats that believe that things happen for a reason. Mm-hmm. So your work is here for a reason. So let's talk about now, we talked about backfire effect. Let's talk about another one of my favorites that we can also look at with this current administration, and we can racialize it. And that is the overconfidence.
Yes. Effect. So we tend to be vastly overconfident about our estimates of reality. When people are asked, you know, are you an above average driver? 93% of college students reply that they're above average drivers. Now think about that. How much experience do they actually have driving, right? So the same sort of estimates apply to the confidence of the Trump administration in its policies. I mean, how many times has the Trump administration tried to, let's say, pass bills that didn't work out, or pass the immigration bill that, you know, try to change the Obamacare in effective ways? That's an example of the with the current administration. And with black people and white people, there's going to be extreme overconfidence on the part of people who are racialized, people who are racist, to have these beliefs to say, oh, you know, this black person, you know, see this black person have an intuitively negative opinion of this black person, even though they don't know anything about this black person. They don't know anything about this black person's characteristic, personality, merit, anything like that. They just have an excessive confidence in their opinions. And we all tend to have an excessive confidence in our opinions. That's something from which we all suffer. So it's really important to focus on being humble and focus on gathering evidence about reality before jumping to conclusion. Mm-hmm.
Do you think the two terms of the Obama administration for those who were whites who were feeling radically, I guess, threatened and marginalized as this country is moving into a brown and diverse space, because we didn't really, I mean, I knew they were there, but not too many people kind of knew that that nothing really had changed. They did, you know, you don't grow up, you just get bigger in a sense. And so when Trump ran, do you think that this was a trigger in response to, well, I don't know if I want more of the same, because more of the same continues to marginalize me. It causes me to challenge my tribal thinking. And I'm comfortable at my default of thinking and my autopilot system. Do you think that the Obama administration, particularly two terms, 8 years, really kind of like triggered that, like almost automatic response, where record numbers of whites came out and voted for Trump, in a sense. They're just a new breed that we didn't even, you know, know that was out there.
So we definitely have evidence that that's what occurred. According to polls on new voters and on white, blue-collar Democrats who voted previously for Obama and for Democrats and now voted for Trump, we know that they had some racist motivations according to polls, according to conversations with them, and new voters who had some racial motivations as well. And it's quite unfortunate that that's what occurred, but it's exactly what occurred. So people felt that not simply was Obama a trigger, but they felt that the country wasn't heading in the direction that they liked, but Trump gave voice to their very negative horn effect sort of intuitions. It's a phenomenon called emotional contagion, where people take on and express the emotions of those they perceive as their leaders. So when Trump was saying things, false things about Mexicans being rapists and criminals and so on, about black people, you know, having it the worst they ever had, something, all of that silly stuff, when he was saying these falsehoods, people were absorbing it and saying, well, if he says it, regardless of whether it's true, I can say it and I can believe it. Mm-hmm. So that's the kind of mental gymnastics that were going on in people's minds.
I love that emotional contagion. That's good stuff. And another thing that we need to look at, particularly as it relates to racialized thinking and biases and the 45th, is the Dunning-Kruger effect. I really love that. That changed my life. Because, I mean, I know I've done that. Mm-hmm. I particularly growing up, you know, you think you know every goddamn thing, you don't know shit, right? You know, let's just keep it real. You know, and so you have a limited amount of information, but you just go and act as if, you know every damn thing. And when I look at our administration, I said, wow, there it is. I had no idea there was a name for it, that this was a science for it. So explain to the public what Dunning-Kruger effect is and how that can be racialized.
Sure. So the Dunning-Kruger effect is a subcomponent of the overconfidence effect. So the Dunning-Kruger effect basically shows that if we have no knowledge, we have a little bit of confidence. If we have a little bit of knowledge, we have a whole lot of confidence. Then as our knowledge grows, we start to learn that we don't know as much as we thought we knew. And so our confidence decreases. But at the stage of very little confidence, we have an excessive, a little amount of knowledge, we have an excessive amount of confidence. So for example, if you remember back in 2016 when Trump was running, he was saying that, well, I have prosecuted the Iraq war and the Afghan war much better than the generals who are prosecuting it. And who was saying that, you know, I'm going to give you great trade agreements, whereas we know, we can see right now what's happening with the tariff war and the trade war, how much it's hurting America. So those are examples. And of course, the same thing about black people and white people. If we see black people in the media as committing various crimes, which are taken as exceptions, in the same way that Muslims commit terrorist acts, and those are put all over television as exceptions. So people who see those things have excessive confidence that they know what black people are about and they know what Muslim people are about, and they don't actually consider the baseline probabilities of how many black people there are in the United States compared to how many commit murders and other criminal acts, how many Muslims there are in the United States compared to how many commit terrorist acts.
Excellent. All right. So then, and I know you have to go because we got about, probably about 5 minutes left here. Illusion of control.
So illusion of control is our perception that we can control events, regardless of whether we can control events or not. And Trump is a perfect example of that. When we talked about Harley Davidson, when Harley Davidson said that they're moving some jobs out of the United States, he started tweeting saying, how can you move jobs out of the United States? That's horrible. That's terrible. You're an American company. I'm going to tax you. Whereas really punitive taxes for a single company for moving jobs out of the United States is not something a president can do. And that's illusion of control, the illusion that he can control events much more than he can. And sort of this sort of paternalistic intuition. And that's, of course, applies to our situation with black people, white people. We imagine that we can control other people around us. We imagine that we can control our interactions with black people, our interactions with white people, and then they will align with our perceptions of what those people are. And we tend to not change our minds based on how based on whether we interact with these people who don't belong to our tribe. We tend to be too anchored, and we perceive that we can control our perceptions much more than we actually can.
Excellent. Two last biases, catastrophizing.
Yes. So we tend to catastrophize situations much more than we should. Catastrophizing refers to us perceiving that a situation is going to be terrible, horrible, negative. Why does that happen? Well, it happens because of our emotions. Our intuitions are based on the fight or flight response. You remember the flight or flight response from the evolutionary background? We have very strong emotions. We tend to perceive that they will continue for a long time. So if we are scared of somebody who belongs to a different tribal group, then we tend to think that, oh, this fear will continue, or if we're sad about that person or something like that, we tend to perceive that this feeling will continue, whereas it actually reduces very quickly if we don't catastrophize and if we don't think that our immediate intuitive feelings will persist.
Excellent. And lastly, which I also found fascinating, and I saw myself in the data in your book, UGG fields.
Yes, UGG fields is also quite relevant to racism. So UGG fields is basically our negative feelings that we acquire around a certain topic or a person or a phenomenon. So for example, the recent, Sarah Huckabee Sanders was thrown out of the Red Hen establishment restaurant. And now a lot of people who are affiliated and supportive of her are developing an UGG field around Red Hen restaurant, that one, and others which had nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. So right now they have, oh, this association, Red Hen means bad. And of course, that same thing develops with people who don't belong to our tribal group. Going back to Muslims and Black people, we see crimes committed by a Black person, again, falsely portrayed as being the essence of what Black people are, and the same thing about Muslims committing terrorist acts. So we develop UGG fields, negative feelings around Black people or Muslims, even though that doesn't represent at all what Black people are or what Muslims are.
And so white fragility, Dr. Robin DiAngelo's work, would be an UGG field. It's like when white people are faced with the conversation of racism, or God forbid that they're called a racist or have racist thought, that's an immediate UGG field.
Yes, so it's a defensive response. So people have a fight or flight response. They perceive a threat and they have a fight or flight response. They either shout back, you know, I'm not racist, how can you say that? Or they're like, no, I'm not going to talk about this. So the first one is a fight response. The second one is a flight response.
Fantastic. Well, this is, you know, you got to come back and we're going to do a series of these things.
Sure.
I can't get enough of you. Dr. Gleb Tsipursky is the author of Truth Seeker's Handbook, a science-based guide, and just run to your phone on Amazon and get that book. Download the Kindle or order the hard copy. It's a nice big thick book, and it becomes the Bible of how you change your thinking. If you feel like you are helpless, hopeless to make a difference in your life, or if you feel that you are being bombarded by life being put on you and you don't know how to handle that, yeah, this is the book. This is the process and this is the work. Dr. Gleb Tsipursky, thank you so much.
Thank you, Philippe. I really appreciate it.
Take care.
You too.